Good morning. I'm the Reverend Diane Dowgiert. My pronouns are she, her, and it is my pleasure to welcome you to worship with the First Unitarian Universalist Church of Nashville. As Unitarian Universalists, our spiritual paths vary, but in this congregation, we have made a covenant together. We affirm our interdependence, celebrate our differences, and work for justice. We are a welcoming congregation, and we deepen our relationships as we serve our congregation's mission to create community, nurture spiritual growth, and act on our values in the broader world, guided by reason and compassion. I'd like to extend a special welcome to visitors worshiping with us this morning. If you are seeking a spiritual home, we hope that you may find it here. If you are with us for the live broadcast of this service on Zoom, won't you please say hello in the chat? We love knowing that you're here. And no matter what platform you're using to join us for worship, you can find useful information about ways to give, faith development resources for all ages, and more in the worship portal on our website, firstuunash.org. We are so glad you are joining us for worship this morning.
Good morning. My name is Elaine Bailey, and I'm filling in for Jay this morning. Our opening hymn comes to us thanks to John Olin and the choir at First Unitarian Church of Baltimore. This Unitarian reworking of a Christian hymn carries an important call to action for our time. Won't you join in the singing?
Aside, till the multitude may virtue of the
The words for our call to worship were written by Christian Schmidt. Let us wake up, not just from the Sunday morning exhaustion, from the wish for a few more drowsy minutes in bed. Let us wake up to this world we live in, to its beauty and wonder, and also to its tragedy and pain. We must wake up to this reality that not all in our world have what we do, no matter however much or little that is. We must wake up to the idea that our wholeness, our lives, are only as complete as the lives of those around us, of those who are inextricably tied in a great web of mutuality, of which all of us are part. We must stay woke. In the words of our friends and colleagues involved in Black Lives Matter, working every day for racial justice in our country, let us wake up. Let us stay awake. Let us stay woke. And now, in this time and these places, let us worship together.
Good morning. I'm Susan Johnston. I'm your vice president of this congregation, and my pronouns are she, her. The words for the chalice lighting were written by Deanna Van Diver. We light this chalice, symbol of our faith alive in this world, naming our vision of collective liberation and daring to remember each other into beloved community.
Good morning. I am Marguerite Mills, your Director of Lifespan Religious Education. And my pronouns are she, her. I want to do something just a little bit different this morning. I want to talk to you about South African Anglican Archbishop Desmond Tutu. He will be 90 years old on October 7th, and the world has been so very blessed to have had him for this long. He is one of what I call my personal prophets. Tutu was a teacher until the beginning of apartheid, which marked the end of schooling for Black people, Black children. He then became a priest, and one of his daughters said that she thinks he became a priest so that he could continue to teach. And that's been my experience, my personal experience, because after all, aren't the best prophets also teachers? His book, No Future Without Forgiveness, which I read for the first time in 2001, changed my life. And I continue to read it again and again. Now, Tutu went on to chair the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, which was essential to South Africa emerging from apartheid without blood running in the streets. The commission offered amnesty to those who would confess their actions during and responsibility for apartheid. But that was necessary. They had to do that. I might also mention that he said to his people, be kind, be nice to the whites. They need you to rediscover their humanity. His life and work are based on the concept of Ubuntu. And this is what he says about that. Ubuntu is very difficult to render into a Western language. It speaks of the very essence of being human. When we want to give high praise to someone, we say, "You Ubuntu." Hey, so-and-so has Ubuntu. Then you are generous, you are hospitable, you are friendly and caring and compassionate. You share what you have. It is to say, my humanity is caught up, is inextricably bound up in yours. We belong in a bundle of life. We say a person is a person through other persons. It's not, I think, therefore I am, but rather, I am human because I belong, I participate, I share. A person with Ubuntu is open and available to others, affirming of others, does not feel threatened that others are able and good, for he or she has a proper self-assurance that comes from knowing that she or he belongs in a greater whole and is diminished when others are diminished. Harmony, friendliness, community are great goods. Anything that subverts, that undermines this sought after good is to be avoided like the plague. To forgive is not just to be altruistic. It is the best form of self-interest. What dehumanizes you inexorably dehumanizes me. It gives people resilience, enabling them to survive and emerge still human, despite all efforts to dehumanize them. The story that is engraved in my brain that still takes my breath away was a very small, simple story and unexpected. He said, on my first visit to Nigeria, I happened to travel to northern Nigeria in a plane piloted by Nigerians. Coming from South Africa, where Blacks did not do such work, I really grew inches with pride in Black achievement. The plane took off smoothly. Then we hit a bit of turbulence. At one moment, we were at one altitude, and the next, we had left our stomachs up there as the plane shuddered and dropped. I was shocked at what I discovered. I found I was saying to myself, I really am bothered that there's no white man in the cockpit. Can these Blacks manage to navigate us out of this horrible experience? It was all involuntary and spontaneous. I would never have believed that I had in fact been so radically brainwashed. I would have denied it vigorously because I prided myself on being an exponent of Black consciousness. But in a crisis, something deeper had emerged. I had accepted a white definition of existence, that whites were somehow superior to and more competent than Blacks. Of course, those Black pilots were able to land the plane quite competently. So, if Desmond Tutu can recognize his own brainwashing, how can I not do the same with my internalized racism? The Truth and Reconciliation Commission gave everyone a choice. And now, today, I have a choice. You have a choice. May it be so. May we work together to make it so. Amen.
Thank you for that story, Marguerite. Desmond Tutu happens to be one of my all-time heroes as well. You may know that we share every Sunday's collection with an organization whose work outside our walls aligns with our values. Our Share the Plate partner for the month of September is Room in the Inn, a fitting agency in a month when we're exploring radical hospitality and what that means. The mission of Room in the Inn is to provide programs that emphasize human development and recovery through education, self-help, and work, centered in community and long-term support for those who call the streets of Nashville home. You can learn more in the worship portal at firstuunash.org, where you can also find a link to our online donation form. As always, your gifts, like your presence among us, are received with gratitude.
I've been mute I've been scorned. Yes, I've been mute, and I've been scorned.
Yes.
I've been mute, and I've been scorned. I've been talked about, shows you mourn. There is trouble all over this world. There is trouble all over this world, children. There is trouble all over this world. There is trouble all over this world.
Marching.
This is the time in the service when we center into our bodies, calm our minds, and open our hearts. We live at a time when those of us who are white are being called again and again to be awake to the realities our Black, Indigenous, and people of color can live with day to day. In our time of prayer and meditation today, I will first offer words from African American author from his essay titled A Case for Reparations by Ta-Nehisi Coates. And this will be followed by words offered by Susan Johnston titled A Prayer for White People. This is not to exclude people of color, but a call to white people to be awake and stay awake, to do the work that is ours to do, the work of reparation, and the call to us to be better allies in the ongoing work of racial justice. These are the words of Ta-Nehisi Coates. What is needed is an airing of family secrets, a settling with old ghosts. What is needed is a healing of the American psyche and the banishment of white guilt. What I'm talking about is more than recompense for past injustices, more than a handout, a payoff, hush money, or a reluctant bribe. What I'm talking about is a national reckoning that would lead to spiritual renewal.
Today's reading, titled A Prayer for White People, was written by Ellen Quadgrass. Sheltered in our homes or going to work at risk for week after week after week, we're edgy, tired, a little raw. We are tender, vulnerable, open, a little more open than usual. Those of us who are white who before might have been distracted, who before might have been too busy, who before might have been preoccupied with our lives, are noticing the ways injustice has happened to people of color the same way again and again and again. Now we have become aware. Please, may we be aware. May we not lose awareness. May we not get distracted. May we not turn away. May we open, really open, accepting the invitation to change, really change our minds, our hearts, our world. When we encounter calls to defund the police, when we encounter calls for reparations, when we hear "follow our lead" from people of color, may we listen, may we learn, may we be open, even if it means rethinking everything you thought you knew about the world. We have, all of us as humans, an enormous opportunity to change one of the oldest injustices in history, to change everything. May we stay vulnerable. May we stay tender. May we take action. Eyes and hearts and minds open.
Today, I have a story to tell, and it's a story from our Unitarian Universalist history. It's a hard story to tell because it reaches far back in time and is still unfolding today. It's a hard story to tell because it includes failures and brokenness. It's an important story to tell because it points us toward the high aspirations of our faith. And it's an inspiring story to tell because it is full of redemption and hope. It's a story about reparations. It was at the 2001 General Assembly of the Unitarian Universalist Association, held in Cleveland, Ohio, that an action of immediate witness was passed. This in itself is not noteworthy. It happens every year. The action of immediate witness process allows Unitarian Universalists to act quickly on social issues deemed to be urgent, knowing that they have the backing of their entire association of congregations. What made the action of immediate witness that was passed in 2001 noteworthy is not only the immediate impact it had, but the impact it is still having today, two decades later. What makes it noteworthy is that it set in motion a process for the righting of a wrong, a process of redemption and healing, repair and restoration, a process of more fully becoming the beloved community we long for and dream of more fully embodying the radical hospitality the principles of our faith call us to, from the inherent worth and dignity of every person, to justice, equity, and compassion in human relations, to respect for the interdependent web of all existence of which we are a part. The action of immediate witness back in 2001 was brought forth by four congregations in Tulsa, Oklahoma, and was titled Reparations for the 1921 Tulsa, Oklahoma Race Riot. Today, it would likely be titled Reparations for the Tulsa, Oklahoma race massacre, because the word massacre more accurately describes the events that took place on June 1st in 1921. The Greenwood District of Tulsa, also known as Black Wall Street, was a prosperous and affluent African-American community. The details of what happened that day are gruesome, so I will not recount them here, only to say that the community of Greenwood was decimated by white rioters and looters, leaving many hundreds of people injured and dead. For the 100 years since, Black Tulsans have often been afraid to speak about what happened for fear it would happen again, and white Tulsans all too happy to have what they and their community had done forgotten. The opening statement of the action of immediate witness reads as follows. Guided by our commitment to justice and by the findings and recommendations of the Tulsa Race Riot, a report by the Oklahoma Commission to Study the Tulsa Race Riot of 1921, and because our Tulsan Unitarian Universalist forebears witnessed an atrocity of ethnic cleansing for which we are responsible to account, to reconcile, and to repair. It goes on to say, whereas the Tulsa Race Riot is consistent with a pattern of assaults and riots in many communities across America, we call for 5 actions. The actions called for in that action of immediate witness were, first, the direct payment of reparations to survivors of the Tulsa Race Riot. Second, the direct payment of reparations to descendants of the victims and of the survivors of the Tulsa Race Riot. Third, the establishment of a scholarship fund available to students affected by the Tulsa Riot. The establishment of an economic development enterprise zone in the historic area of the Greenwood District. And fifth, the creation of a memorial for the reburial of any human remains found in the search for unmarked graves of the massacre victims. While the resolution was long overdue, coming 80 years after the harm had occurred, it is noteworthy in that it acknowledges that it is never too late to do what is possible to right a wrong, never too late to make reparations. In the spring of 2002, 130 survivors of the massacre received payments of $215 each from the Tulsa Metropolitan Ministries, payments that were made possible in part by a $20,000 contribution from the Unitarian Universalist Association. While $215 is a small, even token amount that cannot begin to repay what the Greenwood community lost, it was a symbolic public gesture, acknowledging the damage done with a commitment to the work of repair, which is what reparations is all about. The Reverend Marlon Levenhar, senior minister at All Souls Unitarian Church, was the chair of the Tulsa Metropolitan Ministries at the time. And for Levenhar and the members of his church, it was personal, a recognition of their own complicity and what happened on June 1st, 1921. All Souls was founded just weeks before the 1921 massacre by a group that included Richard Lloyd Jones, a lifelong Unitarian and publisher of the Tulsa Tribune, whose stories included an editorial with an inflammatory title that uses language that I don't want to speak today. But those stories, and along with that editorial, helped foment the massacre. Another noteworthy aspect to the 2001 action of Immediate Witness is that it shifted the focus of our racial justice work from doing work in communities beyond the walls of our congregations to taking an inward look at ourselves. As the Reverend Keith Crone, who serves as director of the Transitions Office at the Unitarian Universalist Association, recently observed, saying, "We're good at saying the rest of the world should be better, not so good at looking at ourselves." For example, we love telling the stories of Unitarians and Universalist forebears who worked in the Underground Railroad, who harbored people escaping enslavement, who worked for the abolition of slavery, and in more recent history, who marched for civil rights with Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. The stories we don't tell as often are the stories of the churches in the North that were built from the profits of cotton mills, with raw materials provided by the labor of enslaved African Americans, or the stories of the churches in the South that were built by the labor of enslaved African Americans, or the stories of some of the ministers who marched with Dr. King only to return to congregations that demanded their resignations. Another noteworthy aspect of the 2001 action of Immediate Witness is that it shifted the conversation about reparations from being primarily about financial restitution to include restorative actions, such as public apologies that acknowledge the ongoing effects of past harm, and actively seeking out the root causes of ongoing racism in our institutions and society at large today, and then making commitments to do the ongoing work of reparations and restoration. This year marked the centennial anniversary of the Tulsa massacre. An article in the UU World Online magazine tells of the ongoing work of reparations. Reverend Levenhar is still involved with Tulsa Metropolitan Ministries, still working to raise money and still working to build collaborative partnerships in the community. All Souls has a publishing house launched with seed money from the family of Richard Lloyd Jones, which recently published The Victory of Greenwood by All Souls member Carlos Moreno. And it tells the story of significant figures in Greenwood's history. All Souls, as a church, wants the press to create a division whose focus is publishing articles, essays, plays, and books by Black writers about the Greenwood story. Levenhar says that's a reparative thing, taking money given by the family that used publishing to harm the community and try to support the community and its views, not from what white people think about this, but the story Black people want to tell. He He goes on to say, let's be a part of something that is good, a collective effort on behalf of a city 100 years later to do the right thing, something truly morally significant and having a true economic impact on those who for 100 years have been waiting. A noteworthy aspect of the First Unitarian Universalist Church of Nashville is your demonstrated commitment to the work of racial justice. It's a large part of what called me to come join in the ministry with you. I'm inspired by the numbers of you who have participated in the Nashville Pledge to End Racism program, and the numbers of you who participate in NOAA, Nashville Organized for Action and Hope, an organization whose work by nature addresses the ongoing systemic issues that perpetuate racism in the greater Nashville community, working on issues like economic inequality, prison reform, education, and affordable housing. In these times of COVID, it can be hard to know what else we can do, what action we can take. So in times like these, I encourage doing what we can. One thing that we can do in this time is to make a commitment to read a book titled Widening the Circle of Concern, which is a report from the Unitarian Universalists Commission on Institutional Change. It's available from the UUA bookstore in hard copy or ebook, and it could be downloaded in PDF form from the UUA website. It's actually very easy to obtain, and I encourage you to do so. I encourage our whole congregation to read this book. And I encourage us all to pay special attention to the section on restoration and reparations. By doing so, it's the way that we create the collective will to do the work of looking at ourselves as an institution and how we can make some systemic change. In closing, I have words from that report, Widening the Circle of Concern. While we work toward a total liberation for all, we must acknowledge the hurts that can be healed, the faults that can be fixed, and the repair possible among communities suffering from the material outcomes of hundreds of years of oppression. May the work of reparation and restoration lead us to a place of radical hospitality, a place of healing and reconciliation for all. May we make it so through our living.
Thank you, Reverend Diane. A lot to think about, a lot to do. Our closing song is There's a River Flowing in My Soul by Faya Rose Touré. Touré is a Black woman, Harvard-educated civil rights activist and litigation attorney. She furthers her message as a prolific songwriter and playwright. I hope you will join members of our choir in singing There's a River Flowing in My Soul.
There's a river flowing in my soul. There's a
The words for the chalice extinguishing were written by Elizabeth Sell Jones. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again.
I leave you today with words that were written by Barbara Peskin. Because of those who came before, we are. In spite of their failings, we believe. Because of and in spite of the horizons of their vision, we too dream. Let us go, remembering to praise, to live in the moment, to love mightily, to bow to the mystery. This service has ended. May our service to the world continue renewed. Go in peace, go in love.